Ah, yes. It should come.
Smin, the worst thing about talking like this is you don't know who is listening to what, so you have no feedback on whether what you are saying makes any sense or not. That is the worst
part. The worst thing about talking like this is you don't know who is listening to what, so you have no feedback on.
Yeah, zero feedback. नो आइडिया जो कुछ भी बोल रहा है तुझे लग रहा है ठीक है तो बोलते जा बस और कुछ नहीं
आदित्य वी आर लाइव
ओके
या वेलकम टू ऑर्थो टीवी ओरिजिनल सीरीज ऑन मस्कुलोस्केलेटल एमआरआई बाय डॉक्टर आदित्य दफ्तरी ऑफ इनोविजन एंड टुडे ही इज गोइंग टू टॉक ऑन अ स्पेसिफिक टॉपिक ट्यूमर्स और नॉट ट्यूमर्स सो नॉट ट्यूमर्स इज द क्वेश्चन एंड वी हैव good ortho onco surgeon friend of mine Dr. Michelle Parekh who's going to be moderating the session so over to Aditya to start his screen share and start his presentation
thank you again for having me here on ortho tv I'm going to talk about today imaging in bone tumors and the way we're going to do this is we're going to break this talk up into this I just like to acknowledge some people who have worked with in the past and who have contributed cases So the way we start with this talk is essentially what do we really want to know? So first, when we look at imaging, is it a tumor? Is it aggressive or not? If it is, can it be treated? And how do we know that? We know by what is inside it. And so we'll divide this talk into two parts, both of which we'll finish today. So fortunately, we won't have to have a second session for this. And we will divide this into radiographs and advanced imaging. So the first part is we need to understand how tumors interact with bone. And therefore, what their appearance is on radiographs, what are aggressive appearances, what are non-aggressive appearances, and then how do we tell what's inside the lesion? So there are two important informative aspects to primary bone tumors. The first is to know the location. So it's almost like if you had to go meet somebody, you want to know what real estate, where they live, and how old they are. These are two important factors that help you to automatically help to give somebody a box or a compartment in which they live in. There are three major features that help us to assess whether a lesion is aggressive or not aggressive. And this is the margins, the periosteal reaction. And then the last thing is the matrix, which is essentially what helps to tell us what lives inside it. So the first two features, the margins and the periosteal reaction, give us an idea of the tempo of the lesion. It's a speedometer. It tells us how fast or slow that lesion is growing. And the third thing will give us, the matrix gives us an idea of what lives inside it. So now that I've said all of this, the first thing to remember that in tumor and infection can be indistinguishable. So it is important if you are going to intervene, you're going to do something, don't do something as a knee-jerk reaction. Make sure you speak to somebody who knows a little bit more about imaging to get a proper understanding to exclude a tumor when you're dealing with an infection, because we have seen many, many cases where a tumor has been incorrectly treated as an infection for a long time and had disastrous outcomes. The second thing is there are certain lesions when you see on radiographs and MR and CT, you can tell they aren't minis. They're like sort of things where you see them and you say, okay, this is a do not touch lesion. Everything is fine. And image-guided biopsies are extremely important. Even if you think something is an infection, it's important for us to know what kind of infection we're dealing with, what is the bug, what is the sensitivity so that you can treat it properly. And on the other hand, if it is a tumor, we want to know which tumor so we know what kind of treatment to start for this. So let's just talk about the tumor war. And the easiest way to think about this, there are two basic parameters to how we can think about the tumor war. So if you think of two wars that all of us know about, the first is the Abhimanyu Chakravyuh thing that is from Mahabharata. And here what happens is you have something in the middle and then you have the body surrounding it completely and containing it. Okay, so this would be the Chakravyuh thing. And the second, you think about the story, the Greek story of the Trojan horse, where they take this horse, all the soldiers hide inside it. They bring it into the fortress, and then these soldiers burst out and they destroy everybody inside the fortress. So the Trojan horse is a very aggressive thing, and the Chakravyuh is something that is a containment process. And if we think about tumors, these are the two wars that we are looking at. So if we think about a lesion that is non-aggressive, then the body contains it very nicely and forms this sort of very nice, contained, thin margin around it. Okay, so there is a very narrow zone of separation. This is normal and this is abnormal. And the distance between normal and abnormal is very small. Okay, it can be slightly thicker, such as in this case, and this would indicate something is non-aggressive. But if you have something that is aggressive, then the distinguishment between normal and abnormal is going to be very hard. In other words, this thing will just be all over the place like this. And when that is the case, you can't tell which is normal and abnormal, or there's no discrete marking point, or the marking point between abnormal and normal is very wide. And this is what we call a zone of transition. So here you have a narrow zone of transition, and here you have a very broad zone of transition. Okay, so that's the other thing to remember. So this is how we think about how tumors react with bone. Now, if you think about a non-aggressive bony lesion, it is well demarcated. You can tell normal from abnormal bone very easily. So you can pretty much draw a line here and you can easily demarcate this lesion. So this is a narrow zone of transition, which is, or you can tell that this is normal and this is the margin of abnormal bone. So this is a very narrow zone of transition, which is non-aggressive. As opposed to this case where you have a tumor here and it's very difficult for you to tell where exactly. If you had to actually mark out the tumor, you would be hard pressed to sort of mark it out, you know. So it becomes very difficult to mark out. So you can't say where the tumor ends and normal bone begins. Similarly here, where is the exact point at which this tumor ends and normal bone begins is a little bit difficult for you to tell. So this is a wide zone of transition. So anytime you see, I can't tell properly where tumor ends and begins, start to think this is a more aggressive process. And anytime you can see that I can see exactly where tumor ends and begins, think that is a less aggressive process. So in order to gauge the tempo, we look at the margins and the periosteal reaction. So here you can see this margin, it's non-aggressive. You can see very clear demarcation between normal and abnormal here. There's no doubt. Similarly here, you can pretty much draw very clearly the separation between normal and abnormal bone. And here also, you can draw clearly the separation between normal and abnormal bone, right? Maybe this margin is less clear, but for the most part, you can. On the other hand, if you look at this lesion, we know that here we can tell normal and abnormal, but here we know that it is destroying bone and coming out, or this cortex is involved. So this is an aggressive periosteal reaction. Here, I find it very difficult between here and here, it's sort of hazily becoming normal to abnormal. So it's a wide zone of transition. This is the case we saw early on with a very wide zone of transition. And this one also, it's very difficult to tell where bone becomes from normal to abnormal. So these are aggressive margins. So that is the case of the margins. Now, the second thing is periosteal reaction. So if we look at this, this has the very slender periosteal reaction here. It's very thin bone that is sort of thinned out, and therefore you are seeing this appearance here. So this is a thinning, but a very clear zone of a clear periosteal reaction. Here you can see a very nice thick periosteal reaction, which is well formed. It almost tells you that the periosteal reaction is holding the tumor in really nicely. In this case of a juxtacortical chondroma, you can see that here the margin looks quite non-aggressive towards the bone side, but out here the margin looks less aggressive. I mean, looks much more aggressive, right? So this is aggressive, this is non-aggressive, you have a mixed pattern. And if you look at this case of an osteosarcoma, you can see that very typical sunburst appearance of periosteal reaction, which is pretty typical for an aggressive bony lesion. So again, the periosteal reaction is another way of telling you whether something is aggressive or non-aggressive. You can have fairly subtle periosteal reactions like this situation here in somebody with an osteosarcoma in the pelvis. And you can have periosteal reactions like this, which look really ugly. You have this large soft tissue mass here along with this periosteal reaction and fracture in somebody who has an osteosarcoma. Or you can have what is this lamellated periosteal reaction in somebody who has had a chronic osteomyelitis, and there are some areas of spiculated periosteal reaction here, which are probably some more aggressive areas. So periosteal reaction can look aggressive from tumor or from osteomyelitis. And this is an example of a telangiectatic osteosarcoma where you can see the lesion here and you can see how the periosteal reaction is aggressive and how that is manifest really nicely on a radiograph. So once you've determined whether something is aggressive or non-aggressive, the next step is to try and determine what is inside this lesion. And for this, we look at the matrix, which means what do the contents look like? So we can have matrix that looks bony. So here you have fairly osseous content inside it. Here you have something that looks like an osseous component. Here this is fairly bony, and here it is bony as well. So when you have osseous components, that is one kind of matrix you can have. The second kind of matrix is when you see these kind of stippled appearances like this, these little rings and arcs, they call them. Okay, they're small little rings and arcs of calcification here. And when you see this, this is usually telling you that something is chondroid or mesenchymal in etiology. Now you can see this in these chondrosarcomas or enchondromas. You can see calcification like this within intraosseous lipomas. And then you can see them again in other more aggressive lesions. So chondrosarcoma. So these are chondroid matrices. Chondroid matrices can be very well defined and sort of, well organized like this, or they can have this area of disorganization within them, which makes you start to think that something could have undergone a malignant transformation. Sometimes you can have infarcts that can look like chondroid lesions. So this is an infarct, right? And this is an enchondroma or a non-aggressive chondroid lesion. So these are other differential considerations when you see a chondroid matrix. Sometimes you can see a fibrous matrix. And then when you think about a fibrous matrix, you think of things like fibrous dysplasia. And here, essentially, it's like looking at something which is a ground glass. So this is that ground glass appearance of the bone, which you see in a fibrous matrix. You can see cystic or lytic appearances, which can be because of either cysts or aneurysmal bone cysts, or sometimes even just expansion of the dural ectasia can produce that, like in this case of the sacrum. The difference to remember is between cystic lesions, which are well circumscribed like this, versus multiple punched out lesions that you can get in somebody who has metastatic disease. So remember, if you see multiple cystic lesions, start to think about metastases in younger patients, things like eosinophilic granuloma. Aneurysmal bone cyst, again, this is a rare example of a cortical aneurysmal bone cyst. Okay, you can sometimes see this sort of striated appearance inside bone, this reticular pattern. And when you see this reticular pattern, particularly in vertebral bodies, then you should think about hemangiomas or vascular lesions. Okay, so you can have hemangiomas or vascular lesions that can look like this. The major differentiation you have to make between a reticular or a permeative pattern is between that and a permeative pattern. So when you see this reticular pattern, which is well organized like this, then you know it could be a vascular lesion like a hemangioma or a lymphatic lesion. But when you see them looking very irregular like this with destruction of bone, then it's more of a permeative pattern, which would be an aggressive bone lesion, and in this case, a high-grade osteosarcoma. Now, I don't want to get too much into this craziness, but basically there are different types of cells in bone, which all of you are aware of, and essentially they undergo different types of transformation to produce different kinds of tumors. And therefore, most tumors tend to live around the growing area of bone, because this is where the tumors tend to be the most, the cells tend to be in various stages of growth and are more likely to go into areas of aggressive growth or tumor formation. So it's important to know that this is where they are. And thanks to this, there is a nice way that you can understand where different bone lesions happen. They typically happen towards the end of bone. And then based on whether they are epiphyseal, metaphyseal, physeal, distal diaphyseal or diaphyseal, cortical or medullary, there are very specific appearances that come for different tumors. So how do we play the game when we see a radiograph? We see a bone lesion. The first thing we want to know is the location. If it's epiphysis, diaphysis, metaphysis, if it's cortex or medulla. And the second thing we want to know is age. Once we know the location of lesion as well as the age, you're actually, believe it or not, almost 80% done in your diagnosis. So pretty much you can say, oh, this age person, lesion in this area, you're close to the diagnosis. Now you add in your information about the tempo, which is the margins and the periosteal reaction, and you're going to get 90 to 95% towards the diagnosis. And then when you start to think about the content, you can get very close to what the diagnosis is. Remember that in today's day and age, things have changed. It's not so simple as just calling something an osteosarcoma or a lymphoma. They need cellular typing to determine what the molecular biology of that lesion is, and based on that, decide on treatment. So while maybe 20, 30 years ago, we were fine saying this is an osteosarcoma, this is a chondrosarcoma, this is whatever else, today we need to understand the cellular characteristics of it even more. And therefore, it is very important to still do tissue sampling before we proceed with treatment. So here's another simple example from the literature on where different lesions, based on their age, where they are, and what the differential considerations can be. So in the first part, we've now again talked about the age and location being very important. We've talked about how tumors interact with bone in different ways, how they result in various radiographic appearances. And once we identify a lesion, we know the age of the patient, we know the location of the lesion, we want to assess its tempo, and then we want to try to understand what kind of cells live inside it. And this will give us a good understanding of what lesion we are dealing with. Now, the second part of this talk is focused on why we use advanced imaging. And we use advanced imaging for a few different reasons. The first is because we want to see the lesion better. So we want to improve lesion conspicuity. The second thing is obviously we want to understand the extent of this lesion. Where is it? How big is it? What are the exact margins? What is it involving locally? So this is the second thing that we want to know. The third thing we can get is improved characterization. With things like MRI, we can differentiate fat and fluid. We can look at with contrast, we can look at vascularity, we can look at fluid levels. And all these things help us to improve our diagnostic yield of what the lesion is. We can look at the aggressiveness of the lesion based on vascularity and metabolic uptake. We can try and determine which part of the lesion is more metabolically active, and therefore we are more likely to get a better biopsy yield, right? And then once we treat the lesion, we can show shrinkage or we can show necrosis within the lesion, which will help us to understand whether our neoadjuvant treatment has worked or not. And then in post-operative surveillance is obviously where we use advanced imaging. So let's take an example of this shoulder radiograph. If you were to look at it and the patient has pain, you would look at it most of the time and say there's probably nothing. If you were really smart and good, you would sort of look at this area of the neck and you'd say, wait a minute, there's something that looks a bit funny here, but you wouldn't be sure. When you get an MRI, it becomes very, very clear that there is a lesion here. This is a rounded lesion, which is intraarticular along the cortex with extensive surrounding edema. And this is pretty classic for an osteoid osteoma. Let's look at another example. Here's a patient, we've got a hip X-ray. And when you look at this hip X-ray, the patient has extensive pain and I have no idea what I'm seeing over here. I really don't see anything abnormal. If I look at the CT image, I start to question if there is something small over here which looks a little bit like an osteoid osteoma. When I do another CT, different sagittal image, I can see this area and I say, this looks suspicious for an osteoid osteoma. We look at an MRI and what you can see is there's fairly intense bone marrow edema here, which confirms that yes, there's definitely something going along in this area. And when we do a bone scan, again, you can see there's definitely increased bony uptake in that area of that acetabulum. So putting all of this together, by using different modalities, we can improve the conspicuity or our degree of confidence that something is truly abnormal. Within MRI itself, there are different techniques that we can use to make a lesion more conspicuous. If we look at this pubic symphysis and we see this lesion in the pubic symphysis on the T2 fat suppressed image, it's really easy to see. But if we go to see it on a T2 non-fat suppressed image, it's probably a little bit harder. If you look at it on this T1 weighted image, you're sort of still struggling to find it. And if you look on this proton density image, you will see it here. So it's important to remember that certain modalities and even within the modality, you can improve your ability to identify a lesion by using the appropriate imaging sequence. Another thing that you can tell is malignant transformations. We already saw this case before. When you look at this lesion, the area in this part is quite nice. It's well demarcated, as is this part. It's fairly well demarcated. But if you look at the midsection, it looks much more distorted. And when we see this much more distorted appearance, it makes us think that this otherwise well-organized, non-aggressive appearing enchondroma is just fine. But when you see it distorting over here centrally, you start to think that there could be some aggressive transformation. And when you look at the MRI, you can see that there's clearly periosteal edema here, periosteal reaction. And you can see that there's distortion in this mid portion of the tumor as compared to the proximal and distal aspects, which tells you that this is undergoing malignant transformation. And so if you were to biopsy this lesion, you would want to go into this area and you would not want to go into this area here, because that would be more likely to give you a benign appearance. This would be the area that will give you the true malignant area. If you look at this X-ray, we're sort of hard pressed in terms of how big this lesion is. If you look at the MRI, you know that this is approximately where the lesion cuts off, but you know that there's edema extending beyond it. And if we look, and we know this is the soft tissue extent of the lesion. And if you look at the bone scan, you can actually see the actual extent of the lesion a little bit better from its bone activity perspective. So we can assess lesions a bit better when we use additional cross-sectional imaging techniques, right? We can see really nicely involvement of adjacent structures, especially the neurovascular structures. So here, for example, is a pelvic neoplasm that you can see here. This is the tumor marked with T, and you can see the sciatic nerve running right next to it. And you know that the lesion is not involved by the tumor, right? We can also do these rather cool little things where we can essentially, fuse on vascular sequences and neural imaging sequences on regular MR images. And here we can see how we have fused the vascular sequence with the regular MRI. And you can see how, as you get down here, where the vessels are in relation to the tumor. And you can see that they're outside the tumor, they're not involved. But here you can see that there's encasement of the tumor by the vessel. Similarly, we can look right around here. And as you come onto a coronal plane, as you superimpose the two, you can see how this tumor is sort of encasing and narrowing this vessel. So we can use various imaging modalities to tell you the extent of involvement of the adjacent neurovascular structures. So once we've looked at the extent and the involvement of this lesion, so we've improved the conspicuity, we've looked at the extent of the lesion, and we've looked at involvement of the neurovascular structures. Now what we're trying to do is understand what is the underlying tissue. And in this, you have live tumor cells, you have necrotic tissue, and you have reaction around the tumor that you want to differentiate. So you want to identify the underlying predominant cell structure, understand the interplay between the tumor and the adjacent tissue, look at some common locations and reactions, vascularity, and then maybe even metabolic imaging. So say, for example, here, we saw this lesion in the radiograph. It looks like a pretty clear, well-circumscribed lesion, and we'd sort of be wondering what this lesion is. Right, you have this non-aggressive appearing lesion with these stippled calcifications denied it. You're not really sure. You do an MRI, and when you do a non-fat suppressed and a fat suppressed image, what you see is the vast majority of this lesion suppresses on the fat suppressed image. And this central portion of the lesion stays bright. And this is essentially an intraosseous lipoma, which has got a central area of mesenchymal or necrotic change, which you're seeing with a slightly brighter signal on the T2 weighted images and darker signal on T1 weighted images. So this is an intraosseous lipoma. On the other hand, you see this lesion, which is a well circumscribed lesion on T1 weighted imaging. It looks very bright on T2 weighted imaging. And one could easily say this is a hematoma or a cystic lesion. But when you see the contrast images, you can see that there's solid enhancement within this lesion. You can see this peripheral rim enhancement and their solid components. And this is actually a myxoid liposarcoma. You can see lesions where you've got multiple fluid levels. So you see these sort of menisci of fluid that are here. And when you see this appearance, you can be pretty sure something is an aneurysmal bone cyst. But you have to be careful to differentiate from a different kind of lesion, which has got these smaller little cystic areas, which can be fluid levels, which ends up being a telangiectatic osteosarcoma. Sometimes a soft tissue mass adjacent to a joint in a young patient, you should be very sure based on location that you must be very high suspicion for a synovial cell sarcoma. certain lesions have got this sort of lobulated fleshy appearance, and what you see inside them sometimes is these little dark areas which look very much like phlebolites, and then this is a slow flow venous vascular malformation or a hemangioma. Now you can further increase the specificity of a tumor by using other techniques. So you can use bone scan, PET CT, MRI, or you can use even more specific items. So for example, in patients who have got, where you're concerned about a malignant or non-malignant compression fracture, you can use something called in and out of phase imaging. You can use dynamic contrast because the contrast enhancement patterns of various lesions can give us a clue as to what it is. And this is particularly something that people talk about in osteoid osteomas. You can use diffusion weighted imaging, which by the rate of diffusion change, one helps to understand whether something is benign or malignant. And in our own work that we looked at it, what you found was an acute benign fractures had a very high diffusion, whereas malignant lesions had sort of less of a diffusion component. So you can use this. It's not dye. You know, these are, again, just tools. You can use things like MR spectroscopy, which helps you to tell what the choline and you know, other chemical contents within them are. And those chemical contents can again give you a sense for whether a lesion is benign or malignant. You can use the concepts of metabolism and bone tumor. So when you use FDG PET, you can tell what the glucose turnover in a lesion is. And when you use a bone scan, you tell what the bone turnover is. And understanding how the interplay of these two things work can help you to identify lesions. So more metabolic activity, that means more FDG activity, means more tumor. But more bone scan activity means more bone turnover. So sometimes if you have a case where you're worried about osteomyelitis versus, or a chronic osteomyelitis versus a neoplasm, the bone, the FDG scan or the metabolic scan will be very bright in a tumor case, and the bone scan will be averagely bright unless it's an osteosarcoma. And similarly, vice versa, if you look at a chronic osteomyelitic case, remember, it's a slow growing process. So the FDG scan or the glucose turnover will be slow, but because the bone is turning over a bit faster, the bone will be higher. So let's look at, for example, this case of a vertebral body involvement. Here you can see that there is, on the FDG scan, there is this big blob of activity extending beyond the lesion and into the soft tissues. And when we look at the bone scan, you see uptake that is primarily within the bone itself, right? So this ended up being a case who had an tuberculous osteomyelitis with paraspinal soft tissue involvement. Similarly, let's look at this case where you had a bone scan, which shows increased uptake along the tibial diaphysis. And here, when you look at the F18 or the bone scan, it is very bright. But when you look at the FDG scan or the metabolic scan, it is not very bright at all. So here we know that there is more bone turnover and less glucose turnover. Therefore, this is more likely a chronic osteomyelitis. PET CT is another interesting way of improving conspicuity and determining the abnormality. If you looked at this CT image, you'd be hard pressed to tell that this is actually tumor involvement here. Whereas if you look at the FDG scan, you can see that area has got increased uptake. Similarly, when you look at this over here, you'd be hard pressed to tell there's a lesion here. But when you fuse the two, you can see that this area is the area of increased metabolic uptake and a metastasis. When you look at this CT image, you'd be thinking that this is actually the abnormal area of bone, and this is all normal bone. But when you fuse the images, what you will find is that actually this was the area of spared bone, and this is all the metabolically active bone. So here, for example, is you can see somebody who is pre-treatment, where you can see these nodes are active, as well as this bone is active, right? This is a patient with tuberculosis with active lymph nodes as well as the bone. When you look at the CT, everything looks relatively normal before treatment. After treatment, remember, things will heal with sclerosis. So if you looked at the CT, you might say, oh my God, there's a sclerotic lesion here, which could be a metastasis. But when you look at the FDG scan, there is no uptake here. So in fact, this is actually a healing metastasis, and that's important, because other that will be important in downgrading this patient. If we had just read the CT, we would say that the nodes have gotten better, but there is new bone metastasis. But when we have both these studies, we can say the nodes are better, there is sclerosis in the bone, but the previously noted metabolic activity has gone away, which indicates that the disease is better. Here's a patient with hyperparathyroidism, having diffuse lesions all over the bones, which actually ended up being small brown tumors. Here's a patient, when you look at the MRI, you're sort of looking at where should I biopsy this lesion from? And when you do the PET scan, what you can see clearly is that this is the most metabolically active area. And so you know that this area is the area that you will be most likely to receive a good result from, rather than the center or any of these areas here where you have necrosis. And therefore, you may just get necrotic tissue. Here's a patient who, if you looked at this patient pre-tumor and post-tumor, the size of the tumor is relatively stable. But if you look at the enhancement before treatment, you can see it's very homogeneous enhancement. Whereas post-treatment, you can see there's very heterogeneous enhancement, which indicates that there is necrosis inside the tumor. Post-operative imaging, we can do fantastic imaging for patients with and without hardware. Here's somebody with an intramedullary rod. And on the MR, you can tell that the tumor has extended up to the proximal femoral shaft. And you can see that same extension here on the gross anatomy specimen also. So post-operative imaging is possible with MRI. So what we've done here in the second section of this talk is we've talked about why we use the newer imaging technique, CT, MR, you know, all the other stuff, because it increases lesion conspicuity locally or for distant lesions. So if you're thinking about where has this lesion traveled locally, they can see that. Plus you can do a whole body PET or a bone scan or whole body screening MRI to see if there's metastatic disease. We can improve the local assessment of extent. So whether there is vascular involvement, what are the exact margins in bone, soft tissue, etc. We have methods by which we can determine whether a lesion is fat containing, fluid containing, which can help us to make a call as to what it is. We can look at the vascularity of the lesions. We can look at some features like fluid levels, which help us to better characterize a lesion. We can understand the aggressiveness of a lesion by looking at things like vascularity and metabolic uptake. We can improve the biopsy yield by going into an area that is specifically metabolically active rather than a necrotic area. And we can look at treatment assessment and follow-up. So after we've treated a patient, we know sort of if there's recurrent disease, residual disease, or how much of the disease is necrosed. And then we can use this in post-operative imaging. So with this, I'll end our talk section of this. And I'll open it up to questions. I think just to summarize again, we've looked at radiographs, how bone tumors react, how we can determine whether things are aggressive, non-aggressive, and how we can use age and location to help us to be very specific about a diagnosis. And in the second part, we've talked about how advanced imaging techniques can help us to make lesions more conspicuous, help us to better characterize these lesions, help us to better understand where these lesions are going, help us to decide how we should target these lesions to biopsy them or treat them, and to follow up how they've resolved or how they've improved. So with that, I will end this talk and open us up to any questions.
Yeah, Michelle, you are more of a specialist in this area. I will ask some basic questions, but you can start first.
So one thing I just wanted to highlight is that for radiographs, you know, when we are asking for a specific bone radiograph, we should incorporate the whole bone. So one joint above and one joint below. Yes. So that gives us a better idea about the extent of the tumor. And also during MRI, the same thing applies. You take the whole bone from one joint above to one joint below. You can see more of the periosteal reaction, which you can miss on the X-ray. You can see a lot of marrow disease, which is not easily seen on the X-ray, to the exact extent of the disease to plan the surgical resection.
Yeah. And also, I think skip lesions. Yes. So whenever you're looking for a patient, if you see something that looks suspicious for a bone tumor, make sure you include the entire bone. So if you're concerned about a lesion in the femur, include the entire femur, but not only that, make sure you look at the hip and the knee joint also, so that you have a sense for sort of where the exact extent of this lesion is. So that's a very important point. Yes. Anything else? Any other questions?
Michelle, go ahead.
Yes. So one more point I wanted to point out, if there are radiologists out there, you know, listening to this, measurements or scale on the MRI is very important, because from a radiologist point of view, you would have a report which will give the extent of the tumor, but not from bony landmarks or, you know, places which are needed to measure your resections. Like they will give you 8 centimeter length of the tumor, which starts somewhere in the epiphysis, goes towards the diaphysis, but it will not measure the distance from the knee joint to the end of the disease. So
right.
scale on the MRI images is one important thing that the radiologist should help us, you know, for the treatment of the patient.
Yeah. So for this, I have two things. One is that, of course, I think if you are an orthopedic surgeon who is treating bone tumors, please, please, please make sure you get electronic images so that you can import these onto your own system and take the measurements for exactly those things that you need in terms of where you want to start your surgery and end. For those of you radiologists who are out there listening to this, and this is something we incorporate in our practice a lot, is when you talk about a bone lesion, obviously talk about the lesion, give its measurements as to where it is. But it's important to say there is. So, for example, if you were to say there is a distal there's an ovoid distal femoral lesion in the metadiaphysis measuring X by Y by Z extending into the adjacent soft tissues, the distal end of the lesion is so many centimeters from the distal femoral articular surface, or the proximal end of the lesion is so many centimeters from the femoral head and neck junction. Or, you know, so give specific bony landmarks as to where in the grand scheme of events this lesion is. Another thing that a fair number of us have now do often is we give a key image. So you give a key image of where the lesion is with some measurements drawn so that it becomes clear. So the idea from a radiologist perspective is not just about saying that there's a lesion, but for actually understanding what value you provide in terms of where the lesion is so that decision making can be done in terms of how to manage this lesion going forward.
Okay. So Aditya, now you showed x-rays and then MRIs, and in one of the cases you also showed a PET scan. So as a radiologist, do you actually have requested that whether the have you recommended a PET scan after the MRI or something like that? Or
yes.
So and would you like to see the PET scan if it is done or something like that? This is what I want to ask.
Yeah, so usually I think for most of us who function as saying that we want to be solution radiologists and not just imaging radiologists, your goal would be to say, listen, get this and then let me look at everything and put it all together for you. Ideally you should not be saying, okay, you just get this, you get, and then you piece it together. Ideally, we should sit and put it all together and say, and this is what happens in, say, ORP, you know, ortho radio meetings or whatever else is, and path meetings, is everybody sits together and comes up with a combined plan. So definitely, I think there's definite value for a single radiologist looking at all the images together and saying, okay, now this is what I think it is. Obviously, that person should be familiar with all the technologies. But just to give you one point of when you have a patient where you see a bone lesion, and this is probably especially true in those older patients where you see a single bone lesion or you see, you know, especially when they're in weird locations to biopsy, like, you know, you get like this one lesion which was picked up incidentally on a cervical spine CT or an MR, or on a thoracic spine CT or an MR, and it's got this very weird location and you're not really sure whether you can biopsy it or not or what the risk is, but it's an older patient and you think it could be metastatic disease. In those cases, sometimes it makes sense to consider, whether you do a chest, abdomen, pelvis CT or whether you do a PET CT scan to see if there are other lesions. And then you may find an easier lesion to go after, something that is less worrisome for the patient. And sometimes you'll find that, it's already an 80-year-old patient or an 85-year-old patient. And the family says, we don't want to do anything more. But if you tell me this is one lesion that's resectable, then I'll do something. But if it's multiple lesions, then I won't. So I'm saying when you see lesions in older patients, think about metastatic disease and think about how you want to understand the full extent of the disease before you do a biopsy or before you do an intervention.
So how important is the PET scan? Michelle, you can also contribute in this question. How important is a PET scan in a malignant case? So you have now diagnosed that this is a malignant osteosarcoma.
Right.
And on MRI, we have said that this is most likely a malignant lesion, which may be most probably osteosarcoma, depending on the age, the X-ray finding and the MRI finding. So in that case, now, how is routinely PET scan done? Is it done for all cases? Do you recommend the PET scan, Aditya, or basically how does it work?
So in general, we don't get a PET scan for every case. There are certain tumors in which we tend to get it. In certain tumors, we tend not to get it. And the question is, why are you getting it? So sometimes you get a PET scan because you see a lesion. You are not sure whether this is an aggressive lesion or a non-aggressive lesion. Or you are not sure which part, especially for something like chondrosarcomas, they tend to be sort of variating around their entire course. So some parts of the chondrosarc will be more aggressive, some parts will be less aggressive. So in some situations, you want to get a PET CT scan to know that, okay, which is there a more aggressive area or a less aggressive area, which helps you to decide and target which part of the lesion you want to biopsy. So one reason for getting a PET scan is to determine whether something is aggressive or non-aggressive. And the second thing is which part of that lesion is more aggressive so that you can go after that, right? That would be one reason to do a PET scan. The other reason to do a PET scan is if you're concerned about multiplicity. So you see a single lesion, but you think it's a potential that this is a multifocal lesion, in which case a PET scan becomes a good thing to do because you can skin the whole body and get a sense for where things are. The third situation where you do it is where you say that, okay, this is a lesion. I am going to treat it somehow, you know, whether with chemo or with radiation or whatever else. And I want to monitor whether it's going to get better or not and how much better it is or not. So based on that, for some lesions, you will say, let me do a pre-op PET CT and then we do a post-op PET CT because it will give me a sense for what the reduction in metabolic value is. And the reason you want to know that is when you see very high reductions in metabolic value and metabolic uptake, they are supposed to be good prognostic indicators for how well somebody will do with a tumor. So three large groups in which you would consider this.
Yeah, so I'll more or less agree to all those three things. One thing is most important, we do a PET scan only after a biopsy report, because for an osteosarcoma, we do a bone scan with CT thorax, which is sufficient. For an Ewing sarcoma, we would need a PET scan. For soft tissue sarcomas, again, CT scan would be enough with USG abdomen pelvis. So there are certain specific tumors which we would not go for a PET scan upfront. But yes, in today's technology, a PET scan has multiple roles. It helps in prognosticating. It helps in finding the most representative or the most active part to do a biopsy from. Or sometimes when the surgeon is not very confident of getting representative tissue from his own biopsy, then we do a PET scan, sit down with the radiologist, do an image-guided biopsy from the most viable area.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of us intervening before doing imaging. So I would always say that if you are considering doing a PET scan, if you're considering doing something, do all the investigative stuff on virgin tissue first. So if you are thinking that, okay, this, you are 99% sure this is an osteosarcoma, you're 90% sure, whatever. If you feel that a PET CT will be required in the post-op management of this patient, do that first. Get everything on virgin tissue, then put your needle in, get your tissue sampling, everything else, and then go ahead and do any additional, you know, whatever else you need to do. But that is sort of my, but it is varied on where it is. And I think also where people have talked about doing a bone scan, doing a chest CT, doing, you know, X, Y, or Z, I think with accessibility of various things, we have to start changing the way we think on these situations. So yes, there are certain guidelines, you should definitely follow those. But I agree completely with Michelle in so much that I think the main thing is once you come across a tumor case, definitely don't hesitate to get a tumor surgeon or a tumor person involved so that you do what is right at the outset, because there are far more horrible complications from not having that hand holding in the beginning and just sort of reactively acting than you know, just being a little bit more conservative, understanding the situation properly and then taking things from there. And today, I mean, I think for orthopedic surgeons, for radiologists, for everybody, I mean, there's a good body in the country called IMSOS, which is the Indian Musculoskeletal Oncology Society. They're very approachable. They've got lots of people around. You should reach out to them. And if you have a case, if you're questioning it, it doesn't, today with WhatsApp, with everything else, it doesn't take long to get an opinion to say, stop, hold off. So don't be in a hurry to react on something. I think, you know, reach out. There are enough people who can give you sensible advice on how to handle these things, what the management forward is. And things are changing at a reasonable rate. So sort of if you're not something you do routinely, then definitely reach out to somebody who does it more routinely.
Okay. And now the whole confusion comes, the reason Michelle is gone.
Yeah.
He must have got disconnected.
He's upset.
He himself is an IMSOS member.
I know. Yeah.
So my query to you is that, why I think I got knocked out. So he's writing like this. So he's, so I'll tell him, just come back using the same link.
Yeah.
So the my query to you is that why he was saying biopsy first is the issue is that if he's 100% sure that, or not 100%, you cannot be sure, but you've got an MRI done and you feel that it could be a GCT, like a giant cell tumor, where you don't have to do a PET scan at all.
Yeah.
So then basically PET scan will become an become
yes. A, yeah. Yes. Yes. So that's what I said. And that's what I said. I said, if for any reason you feel that PET is going to play a role in the management of this lesion, then do that before you do the biopsy. If you feel that there's going to be no role for a PET in that lesion, then obviously don't waste your time.
Okay. Now, let me speak to you about some part of interventional radiology which you are doing for benign tumors. Are you doing a cystic intervention, cystic lesion, like a simple bone cyst or an endosomal bone cyst, or the surgeon only does it?
Usually,
you as a radiologist?
Yeah, usually I think for cystic bone lesions, in terms of an ABC or a UBC and putting something inside it, there's not that many radiologists that I know who are doing a lot of that stuff.
Mm.
I think where you're seeing a lot of radiologists being involved is definitely in the management of osteoid osteomas, because we can do radio frequency ablation. It's sort of the standard of care today. It's easy to do under a CT scanner. And you know, you have a radio frequency probe and it works very well. There is a role for probably using it. You know, some people are exploring the use of it in things like chondroblastomas. And then obviously in the oncology world, a lot of the, you know, they are doing cryo ablations, they are doing radio frequency ablations, they are doing injections with radioisotopes into tumors, and interventional radiologists are doing vascular embolizations to reduce the vascularity of a tumor before you do procedures. So this will be the large category of interventional procedures that radiologists are doing when it comes to bone lesions. And apart from this, obviously a lot of the image guided biopsies, in terms of accessing this tissue and getting it done. And the nice thing is, if you're a radiologist who does multimodality stuff, you can figure out whether somebody is faster to do by a CT or an MR or by ultrasound guidance or whatever the best possible modality to get something done efficiently is.
Yes. Okay. I think Michelle is not coming back. My internet is banned.
He's upset now.
Basically that means the intervention mainly is done, very rarely is done except for osteoid osteoma. Now, the osteoid osteoma also, some orthopedic surgeons basically like to drill it.
Yes.
Yeah. Because they were actually, when I was doing my residency, we used to just open it. If it's a simple area,
yeah,
we used to just open it up. But now we are just doing a drilling using C-arm or CT guided biopsy. A CT guidance also. I have also done one CT guidance, two CT guidance drilling of the osteoid osteoma. But I think the radio frequency ablation is a more non-invasive procedure, because in drilling, you're destroying a normal bone also.
Well, so you will in radio frequency ablation also destroy some normal bone. There are good results with drilling. I think the key thing for any of these lesions is that you target the lesion properly. Because when you see osteoid osteoma, you see even some of the examples I showed you, they are fairly small, innocuous looking lesions. And when we've seen enough cases that come back with pain after surgery, because somebody's lopped off the periosteal reaction, but they haven't gotten to the nidus. So what radio frequency ablation with, under CT guidance allows you to do is to be A, very focused. B, because that radio frequency ablation has a certain penumbra and, area around it, you can hit a fairly small area. And today we have various probes of various different types. So the standard probe that everybody uses is one that's got a bunch of prongs, and that has a fairly large area of burn, which can be 1.5 to 2 centimeters. But you also now have these really small probes that we've used, which have even just a 0.5 centimeter burn circumference. So if you are exactly within the lesion, you pretty much burn right around the lesion. So you reduce the amount of destruction of adjacent tissue. I think technology wise, people have done various things. The results will be a variety of things. And that's sort of what you will end up seeing.
So let me just show you through one case. This was the first time ever me and Dr. Taral Langda together did this.
Mm-hmm.
We did a CT guided osteoid osteoma excision using this. See, this was an osteoid osteoma.
Right.
And the patient was given GA in a CT scanner machine.
Fine.
And this is all the position. These are the needles, how we confirm. These are the instruments which we use.
Right.
This is how the anesthesia was given. See, the anesthetist is standing here behind.
Right.
And the surgeon is on the other side. And this is where the surgeon is standing.
Right.
And that is how we got marked. And I think the same way you're doing the radio frequency ablation also, very similar.
Right. Right.
This is how we did the drilling.
Right.
This was the first case ever which I assisted him.
Yeah.
He must have done before that. So, Michelle. Yeah. Sorry, yeah, Aditya.
No, no, go ahead. That's fine.
Yeah, I was going to go by Michelle. Do you have any comments on this procedure? Have you done this procedure?
So, I have not
done it, or do it under CM?
So, under a CT scanner, it has been done these days and it is giving good results. If you can localize it well, you can drill the nidus and the pain goes away immediately, and the recurrence rates are also less. But this is still a relatively newer procedure, and I would still go by RFA. You know, that is a better procedure done under control and with the new prongs, like Dr. Daftari said, that the adjacent tissue damage is decreased and it doesn't really cause collapse of the bone or anything else.
Yeah, so one thing that you have to remember, and I've seen this a couple of times actually, when you do radio frequency, even when you do this procedure, is that especially if it, we see a fair number, like even in your case, of things in the femoral neck. And if you drill or you do an RF ablation over there, you are causing some damage, and it's usually to the compressive trabeculae. So you are causing some damage over there. And sometimes if you're just very aggressive about letting people to go back into play and doing everything, especially when you have little kids, there is a chance of your getting secondary fractures. Okay, so I have at least one case of somebody with a Taylor neck osteoma, which we did a radio frequency ablation on. The guy was a gym trainer. We told him, don't do anything, you know, relax for a few days, this, that, and the other. And he came back about, you know, 8-10 weeks later saying, I have intense pain and my osteoid osteoma has come back. And I think the important thing to remember with osteoid osteomas from that standpoint is osteoid osteomas, their CT appearance and even their MR appearance can look fairly similar even post-treatment. And what actually goes away is their metabolic uptake on like a bone scan or a PET scan. And in this case, what happened is because that thing still looked like in the CT, the radiologist who reported it said osteoid osteoma is still there. So he came back to us, we talked to him, we said, I don't think this is the osteoid osteoma. And then we repeated a bone scan. And what you see is it's actually the uptake that's going along a fracture line. So the patient was developing a Taylor neck stress fracture rather than the osteoid osteoma causing pain. So I think the important thing to remember is whenever you're dealing with post-op pain with osteoid osteomas or any tumor tissue, it's important that you have people who understand how these things behave and what they do. You know, otherwise you will end up doing things that can be quite harmful to the patient.
Yeah, so I would like to share one report with you of your company only.
Oh boy, now we're in trouble.
So there was this patient who came to me with, she was in fact given AKT. She was given AKT for 2-3 months. She had come to me. She was having pain. And her MRI reported synovial thickening and everything. Like somehow it was reported here.
Yeah.
But Malini, when this patient was referred to you, and Malini was intelligent enough to tell them to do a CT also.
Right.
So when they did the CT and they picked up this osteoid osteoma, this was the one which we had drilled.
Correct.
That is a different case. So this nobody else was able to pick up before I had referred this patient to you.
But
she had already undergone two MRIs and AKT for 3 months.
Yeah.
And a biopsy also, and a biopsy of the, sorry, aspiration of the hip joint or something like that, because there was a few.
Yeah. So I think the key thing to remember over here is that osteoid osteomas, when you see them in the tibial, when you see them in the long bone shaft, then you end up seeing a cystic lesion with a nice sclerotic rim around them. But when you see them in intra-articular, they tend not to have as much sclerosis around them. And they produce actually a synovitis in the joint, and they produce a lot of adjacent bone edema. So the knee-jerk reaction for anybody who sees bone marrow edema along with joint effusion is to say this is an infection. But when you sort of look at that bone marrow edema and you trace it, you will see that it's all emanating from a central point. And when you look at that central point very closely, you will figure out that that is an osteoid osteoma. So this is exactly the case over here. And I mean, obviously the patient was very lucky, somebody like Malini saw, because Malini is just absolutely fantastic with detecting. So osteoid osteoma, when you see a hip joint effusion with bone marrow edema, try and determine where that bone marrow edema's epicenter is. And that will be a clue to helping you to identify whether something is an osteoid osteoma. The other thing that gets mistaken like that is a subchondral insufficiency fracture. So that tends to go towards the femoral head, especially the articular surface. And osteoid osteomas will tend to emanate more towards the neck. And a similar thing that you have to differentiate from sometimes is when you see stress fractures in the femoral neck. That can also be
here. The insufficiency fractures are usually here.
Yeah, but you can see them a little up and down, and as can the osteodosteoma. So it's not, but these are the things that should run through your head when you see that.
Okay. I think I'm done with my questions because this is the maximum of my oncology practice.
Excellent.
Michelle, do you want to ask him anything else?
No.
Okay. Thank you, Aditya. It
Not
has
at
been
all.
A wonderful
Thank you
series.
For having me here.
Yeah. Yeah. The four series on MRI remain on our Ortho TV platform for you to go and review. The first one was on the MRI of the knee. The second one was on MRI of the shoulder. Third one was of MRI of ankle. And now today we had discussed a lot about tumors, benign, malignant. Today, in fact, it was not only MRI, but it was X-ray, CT scan, MRI, everything, which we covered. So we had a wonderful time with you, Aditya.
Thank you.
We will be, you keep on sending your videos and we will be forwarding them to our viewers and Ortho TV for them to see. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for doing this.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.